Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Leena Kashyap. I am retired now, but I was the former deputy director and emeritus professor at the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. Today, I am going to talk about the changing situations of families in the module on family studies as a field of practice in social work. This is within the course of fields of practice in social work. Let me begin by telling you that families, I think you all know that they are basic units of society and they perform essential functions such as rearing children, giving care and attention to all members of the family. They serve as a source of stability, continuity and development. And families are essential to the country's future as they provide nurturing ground for generations to come. There have been times when people say that families are dying, but I think that families have adapted to changing times and have shown tremendous resilience to changing times. Today, in the last few decades, what we realize is, and you are all aware that every country in the world has been touched by globalization. And families have been directly impacted by the globalization. What do we mean by globalization? And what has happened as a result of globalization? Well, there has been a free market. There have been economic changes in terms of free market economies, not protected economies. There have been tremendous technological advances which have had both which have been advantages as well as have led to retrenchments in employment. But the advantages have been that people are able to work faster, they are able to achieve a lot more. We have had tremendous advances in transport and communication. Today, a lot of our cities are, we hope that they turn into smart cities, but every part of our country is more or less linked through some kind of transport. And one of the biggest revolutions I have seen is that today, every single person, almost every person owns a mobile phone. So the communication and the connection that has grown over the years is tremendous. There has been the liberalization of the economy, privatization, which means that less is owned by the government, more is owned by private citizens. There has been a lot of urbanization as well. People have moved from rural areas to urban areas in search of jobs, in search of a better life, especially as there have been less yields from agriculture. There have been budgetary cuts. You know, all this what I have said so far seems as if good things have happened, but on the other hand, there have been budgetary cuts on health, on education, on housing by the government. There have been rural to urban migrations as well as international migrations. When international migrations have happened, very often it is the urban educated families which have migrated, and the entire families have migrated. When it has been rural to urban migration, very often it is only the man or the woman who has migrated, leaving the rest of the family behind, which has had its own consequences on the families, which I'll talk a little more as we go along. Now, how has economic transformation affected families? Because of globalization, there has been rising unemployment and underemployment. This has created a lot of restlessness among youth. People have been pushed into the unregulated and insecure informal sector of the economy because they were not able to get jobs in the formal economy. This has also led to financial pressures on families due to inflation. Because of the consumerism that has grown, families' desire, you know, the desire for consumer goods has grown with it, and with it inflation, and so there have been financial pressures on the family. Economic insecurity has sometimes manifested itself in family disintegration, violence, abuse of its members. It has led to domestic violence. It has led to child abuse. We also see demographic changes that have happened. We find that in many families, there's been a growing number of dependent aging population. Though we claim that we have economic dividend, so to say, a demographic dividend, because we have a young population, almost around 6 million people are below 25 years of age. And so that is the thing, whereas compared to, say, populations in Japan and in Germany and in Europe, where they have a greater aging population than a youth population. We also find that there has been a reduction in family size due to economic difficulties. Earlier, people used to have more children because the more children, the more hands which would help in agriculture and in other activities of the done by the family. What we also find, which is not a very healthy thing, is that the sex child ratio is 1,000 boys to only 943 girls, and this is the 2011 census. But what we do, as I mentioned earlier, that we do have a demographic dividend. What we do with that and how we empower this youth is, it will matter a lot whether it actually turns into a dividend or a liability. Now, let's look at the impact of migration. People have migrated to, say, countries like USA and UK or Australia. There have been, they have had greater opportunities and better employment prospects. They have improved their quality of life there. And because most of these migrants have been the urban, educated, middle class minorities. But when job prospects are low at home, often, as I said earlier, it's only the man and the woman or the woman who migrates. For instance, a lot of men have migrated, say, to the Gulf countries or even to Southeast Asia in search of jobs, in search of employment. Now, these are the people who are semi-skilled or unskilled laborers. So their earnings, their remittances, and their what they send home is also much less. Now, what happens in such situations is that the wife and children who are left at home, they are unable to cope with the little money that the man householder is able to send home, with the result that the wife who becomes a single parent has to earn to supplement the family income, and with the result that children are often left to their own resources. Sometimes it's the woman who has migrated. For instance, we find a lot of nurses, women nurses, who have gone to Gulf countries. Now, when women migrate, then there is a redistribution of family responsibilities as well. The father who is with left with the children, has to become the father and the mother for his children. And with the result that maybe in these situations, the elder child has had to leave studying and start and look after the younger children. Parental separation also has led, has impacted the child's studies, the child's personality and conduct and attitude towards life and society. There have also been a breakdown in family ties and conjugal, because of this conjugal separation. Long separation, of the spouses has sometimes led to extramarital relationships, has left to, with the result that there has been family breakdown. When there has been, as I'm sure you're aware, there has been a large scale urban to rural migration for employment. Why has this been happening? Because there has been increasing fragmentation of land. As the father distributes his land to all his sons, the land that each son receives is much less. And again, when that son distributes land to his children, again it is redistributed. So this fragmentation of land has led to diminishing returns, because he has a lot less land from which to earn. And this, along with this, what has happened on the other hand, in the urban areas, there has been a growth of labor industries. And so poor people have migrated from rural areas to urban areas. But as you are all well aware, and I'm sure you've seen them, where do these poor rural migrants live? On the periphery of cities, in very poor sanitary and health conditions. They build these shanty towns and live there. Some of them come only for a short while, for a couple of months, and then go back again to their villages. Some of them come more permanently because they find that they may be landless laborers, they may be farmers who have very little land, and so it doesn't make sense to live only through cultivation. So this is what happens. As I said earlier, when men migrate alone, and when what they send home, the remittance, when it is very small, women have to seek employment outside. Now these women who are single mothers, most often they are illiterate, they lack any skills, so they become fully exploited in the unorganized labor. They normally would get jobs as agricultural hands in the rural areas, or as maid servants or domestic help in the urban areas. Now, what has the biggest impact that globalization has had is on the role of women. What has been happening? There have been a lot of social reforms and legislation relating to changing and improving the situation of women in India. Women have been encouraged to go for higher education, and they have had been encouraged, and they themselves, because of higher education, they also want to seek employment opportunities. Some of them, of course, have to seek employment opportunities out of the fact that they have to supplement the family income. But when women want to seek employment because they are now more educated and can compete in a thing, they also want to be economically independent. And so because of their education and employment, changing status in education and as a result of education and employment, they now command a much higher status and much more respect within the family. And especially when we have nuclear families, where very often the situation is that the parents come to live in their son's house. So earlier the situation was that the son remained in his parents' house and brought his wife to his parents' house to live with the family. Here in urban areas, the situation is that the old parents who originally are from rural areas come into the cities and they live in their sons' homes. Now, this changes the equation in terms of the mother-in-law, daughter-in-law relationship. And along with education and employment, that has changed the relationship between the women folk in the family. Now, with women achieving economic independence, they also want legal equality. And there have been legislations that have tried to improve the legal status of women as well. In fact, today, in the present times, Hindu women have now gained inheritance rights. And today, I'm sure you must have been reading in the papers about the, you know, the government's move to try and help Muslim women, you know, attain more civic and economic independence through the abolition of the triple talaq, for instance. Now, there is a changing, with all these changes, women themselves now perceive themselves differently. Their aspirations have changed. Their expectations from their family members have changed. And with it, their aspirations even from their spouses have changed. They want even greater equality within the marriage relationship as well. However, this is not to say that all women in India have achieved this. Majority of women are still not very literate, are only semi-literate if at all. So they are still discriminated against, and they have very few choices, in terms of education, in terms of employment. They have to take what they are able to get. And they are very much, women in India are very much still limited by patriarchal values, religious dogmas. So that is not to say that everything is very rosy. Now, there have been a lot of change in the roles of men and women. Earlier, there was a very strict compartmentalization in terms of the man is the breadwinner and the woman is the housekeeper. But things have changed today. With the greater involvement of women in the labor force, a term has been coined which is called feminization of the labor force. There has been a very I would say, to employ women only in certain industries with the men. For instance, in the hospitality industry, they would prefer that only women come from the rural areas and work in the urban areas, leaving the men and the children behind. The result is that the men do not get adequate jobs, but the women who get the jobs, they are not paid a man's wage. They are paid much less than what a man would be paid for the same job. When we look at certain middle class families who have dual incomes, where both the husband and wife are working, then what is happening is that they are facing problems of childcare. Where the mothers are working outside and the families are living in nuclear families where there is no grandparent or extended family member to help out with the care of the child. Now, there have been structural changes within the family as well. Earlier, there was the monolith of the, in Western world, there's the monolith of the nuclear family. In India, we had the joint family system for a long time to come. And in fact, some experts say that the joint family is actually now disappearing. In my opinion, and in the opinion of a lot of experts, joint family is by no means disappearing. What has happened is that when the sons of the patriarch get married, when they have their own children, they may move out and form their own joint families with their children and the children's spouses. And what is also happening, that this is a cyclical process. A joint family starts becoming nuclear to once again form into a joint family. But besides the joint and nuclear families, what we've always had, but now they are receiving greater visibility, are that we have now single parent families. We also have step families, because today more and more men are remarrying. Even a few women are remarrying. And so there are children of first marriages as well as children of the new marriage. Then there are female headed families where the male member is missing or is not working or is ill. Then there are separated and divorced families. We find the phenomenon of same-sex families today, though of course this is not so common. But we also have couples without children, and we also have live-in couples. Now, let me tell you something about the state, the law, and the family. Because this is important to know that with this changing family, what is happening as far as family policies and family law is concerned. Actually speaking, India does not have a systematic, coherent family policy. The Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has essentially focused on maternal and child health and population control. However, various legislations, which could be called family laws, have been enacted, amended and implemented by the government of India as well as the state governments as and when necessitated. What we also have is that different religious groups, such as Hindus, Muslims, Christians, each have their own separate personal laws and are governed by these their respective personal laws in matters of marriage, divorce, succession, adoption, guardianship, and maintenance. Now, I will not go into what each one of these laws talk about. I will just briefly enumerate to you a few of the important family laws that we have in our country, and some of these have been amended from time to time. So we have the Hindu Widows Remarriage Act of 1956. Then we have the Indian Christian Marriage Act of 1872. We have the Child Marriage Restraint Act, which was amended in 1978. We have the Parsi Marriage and Divorce Act of 1936. We have the Foreign Marriage Act and the Special Marriage Act. We also have the Hindu Marriage and Divorce Act in 1955. We have the Hindu Succession Act of 1956. And we have the Hindu Minority and Guardianship Act of 56. We have the Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act of 56. We have the Suppression of Immoral Traffic, the Dowry Prohibition Act, which is a little more recent, which was amended in 1986. The Muslim Women Protection of Rights and Divorce Act of 1986. The Child Labor Prohibition and Regulation Act of 1986. And the most recent act is the Domestic Violence Act of 2005. What we find in all these acts is that the personal laws of the different communities, the Parsis, the Muslims, they are very old. You know, they are, some of them are just after independence or just before independence. Some of the newer acts are good acts and they require, but still there is need for a lot of reform in many of these acts because they still do not provide what is needed for women. Also, the implementation of these acts is also very important. One of the major legislations is the Family Court Act, and I would like to say a little bit about it. This was enacted in 1984. Now, it was what used to happen that when you go to a court of law, and I hope you never have to go, but cases take between 10 years or a lifetime to get resolved and for any judgment to be passed. So marriage or divorces used to go on for years and years, and this was doing a lot of disservice to both the spouses, but especially the women, and it had adverse effects on the children as well. So the Family Courts Act was expected to deal with marriage or matrimonial dissolution, maintenance and alimony, custody, education and support of children, and settlement of spousal property and guardianship and custody of the child. Now, it was supposed to speedily resolve it. There was the idea was that it should promote conciliation and a secure speedy settlement. The whole idea was that instead of taking on an adversarial position between the two parties, that is the husband and the wife, the idea was that the couple concerned would first be sent to a counselor who would try and settle differences, help the couple to settle differences if it is at all possible. And if not possible, then only would the counselor then suggest that they go in for a divorce. So the whole point was that it should be non-adversarial, so that because when it is non-adversarial, the impact on the children is a little less. Of course, there is still going to be an impact on the children. This act stressed the importance of professional family counselors in the process of adjudication. And also the judges were, the act says that at least some of the judges should be women, and that they should have some background in dealing with matrimonial matters. And also one of the other reasons for setting up this family courts is that the existing courts lacked the infrastructure, facilities and support system. For instance, children would also often be brought to the family to the court, and they might have to wait the whole day. There is no facility at all for families to be sitting around in courts the whole day. In a family court, there is a children's room where the children can wait, where spouses, when it is guardianship is given to one spouse and visitation rights are given to the other spouse, then that is the place when the spouse with visitation rights can meet the children. And so it's a less a frightening place for children as well. Now, today, with all these changes, what are we finding? That the family as a system has shown tremendous strength, resilience and capacity to adapt to changing times. It has neither dissolved, it has neither broken. In fact, it has only adapted and taken on different structures, but shown tremendous resilience. What today we find that Indian families have retained, in a way, their patrilineal and patrilocal structure. However, the norms governing the interaction and behavior of their members have become far more flexible. Family members are able to have a say in what they want, and in the way the resources within the family resources are shared. as a system, it has become more flexible and open today. Education and modernization, as I'd said earlier, have brought importance to individuals in the family, especially the women. Family members are also questioning the control and distribution of resources within the family, as well as the roles, obligations, and relationships. Today, some of these roles and relationships have changed in terms of, they no longer are able to play the roles that they used to play in, say, our parents' time. In conclusion, I would like to say that Indian families are in a state of transition as they grapple with issues of continuity and change. A large number of families, as a result of globalization, urbanization, and modernization, have been pushed into difficult situations. As a result, families more than ever before are in need of professional support to recognize their unique strengths and to bring a more equitable power balance within the family relationships. They also need support in obtaining their entitlements from the larger systems in society. So, what we have seen in this subsection is that is the changing family situation in India today, and what it has done to family relationships within the family as well as family's relationships with its environment. Some of these legislations, you're welcome to look at some of the structure of those legislations. You are also welcome to look at some of the readings that I have suggested, after the lecture. Thank you.